like to welcome to the stage now Patrick Ouellette to tell us his amazing story with the Lucas device. Welcome, Patrick.
Good evening, everybody. Thank you for having me tonight. And I'd like to thank the Saints Foundation for giving me the opportunity to tell my story. I'm here tonight very simply because I died. Almost. Most of the time people think of almost as a negative connotation. I almost got the job. I almost scored the touchdown. The Vikings almost made it to the Super Bowl. But in my case, almost was great. In my story, there's a lot of people that worked really hard for that almost. I had to be at the right place at the right time. They had to be great people that helped me, needed the right tools. And then we can't forget that you can't have that many coincidences without having help from above. So let me tell you a bit my story. So it was a cold February morning, actually Super Bowl weekend on the Friday. And as I always do on Friday mornings, I go and play hockey from 6 a.m. to 7 a.m., being a good Minnesotan. And then I don't remember much about that morning, but I remember I played really great. So, you know, you go, take the shower, get ready. Then I was on my way home, and I decided to stop and do a little detour and stop in Shakopee to go pick up some toothpaste at my dentist. So instead of going home to Bloomington, close to the airport, I decided to do that detour. And then after I purchased that toothpaste, I got in my car, and then I got a cramp. You know, everybody's got a cramp once in a while. This one didn't feel quite right. Kind of hurt. So then I said, you know what? I've worked in Shakopee for many years, and I knew exactly where St. Francis was. So I said, you know what? I'll do a little detour. So I went on first, and then after that, I turned on Marshall. And then I realized that it's probably the good decision I made to turn on Marshall and head towards the hospital. Because my cramp got worse and worse, and the pain got really, really bad. And also, I kept hitting every light on Marshall. There's a lot of lights on Marshall. So then the sports in me kicked in. One more second, one more stride, one more light. I needed to make it to the hospital. I made it to the parking lot. And then after that, I turned, I was making a beeline, I was looking where the entrance was, and then I don't remember anything else. The security camera at the hospital showed that my car stopped in the middle of the parking lot, then suddenly accelerated. Jumped over a curb, ended up in a grassy area, and then I stopped 10 feet short of the wall of the hospital, right near the ambulance door, nearly hitting somebody on the sidewalk. But thank God, I didn't hit anybody, I didn't hurt anybody. And then that's when things got interesting, believe it or not. Talking about how many things needed to work and how many things are at play. First, there was a security guard who happened to be walking by. He saw me. He saw my car crash. He called it in. There was the person, so he rushed, and in a matter of seconds, they were at my car, him and the person I almost hit. And then they smashed the windows to get to me inside the car. And then the ER staff, because they called it in, they started coming out of the ambulance door because I was close enough. Had I been further away, it wouldn't have been possible. I had crashed and stopped just short, so it was possible for them to come and get me. I apparently helped. I got out of the car. I got on the gurney on my own power. And then when entering, going in the gurney, in that emergency room, that's when I went to full-blown cardiac arrest. Immediately, the staff at St. Francis, they jumped into action. They right away, they put the Lucas machine on me because it started pumping and giving me CPR where my heart wouldn't function. It didn't look like my heart was gonna function. So then the staff did everything they could, and then they called Abbott Northwest. And normally, somebody who's not stabilized, they don't usually take people like that. But in that case, they did. So then they were going to send me to Abbott Northwest from Shakopee Friday morning, rush hour. then the helicopter had left a few hours before. But lo and behold, there was an ambulance there because the security guard called it in as an accident. So an ambulance showed up, an ambulance was there. So then they put me on ice. They loaded me up in the ambulance, and then they shipped me to Abbott. The whole time, my heart had stopped for almost an hour. It was being kept alive because of the Lucas machine and the CPR. And 5 minutes before I got to Abbott Northwest, my heart started pumping again. Then I went into surgery, and they put in a stent. But even then, my heart wouldn't work. So then more people, more surgeon, more staff helped me keep me alive. And then after that tough day, I was still alive. I was still alive, and my family was very grateful for that. But I wasn't out of the woods. I was plugged into every machine imaginable. ECMO, tubes breathing for me, everything. It was a rough couple of days, but then I started to improve. My heart had been, they thought it was damaged. It wasn't pumping right, worthy of being on a transplant list. But then I kept improving. And the following Tuesday, I've improved so much, they woke me up. They took the machines off progressively, and then they woke me up because I was in induced coma for all that time. And then the first three things, I had no idea what happened. So I said, what happened? Are the kids okay? And did I make it to hockey? So then the nurse asked me, what's my name? I said, Patrick Ouellette. What's your middle name? Well, I don't have it. I don't have one. I lost it in the marriage because when I signed my name on the marriage certificate, I didn't put my middle name. At that point, my wife realized I was going to be okay. So then the next day, I was taken out of the ICU. And then a week later, I was already home. I'd improved so much. A few weeks later, I went back for cognitive test because I was on the Cool-It procedure, and things were getting back to normal. There was no organ damage. My brain seemed to be fine. My wife will question that. But my brain was at least as it was before. There was no damage to any of the other organs. A few weeks later, I went to the cardiologist for more tests, and my heart had come back to normal level and normal functions. It was incredible. The staff and the people that cared for me, they did it so quickly, and they were able to jump and get me going and keep me alive, keep me intact for as long as it could, as they could. That's what saved my life. That really, they helped me. It's been 11 weeks since I've had my heart failure. I'm a success story, but that's because of all the people. Thank you. But it shouldn't be me that you applaud. I'm just the schmuck that had a heart failure. It's really the people at St. Francis with their quick action and putting the Lucas machine and putting all their knowledge. I crashed in on a Friday morning. They didn't have any prep time, yet they performed heroically. Those are the guys. So then I realized there's so many people that helped me stay alive or make my death an almost and not a reality. I needed to meet some of these people. So I went to St. Francis at the beginning of April, and I met the people at St. Francis. It was one of the most extraordinary experiences of my life. It was so touching to see how much they cared. They were telling me, each one of them was telling me their part of their story to keep me alive. And it's not just that they're trained and they're caregivers. They cared. You can tell it on their face. When I saw some of them tonight, you can tell they really care about what happens. They were genuinely happy to see me. And later on that day, Megan from St. Francis sent me a picture, a group picture of everybody, including myself. And I posted it on Facebook. And I was writing a caption to tell all my friends and family, the people that saved my life. I cried a lot. How do you tell people that you owe them your life, that they saved your life? It's not something easy, but it was one of the toughest things I ever had to write and one of the most satisfying things I've ever had to write in my life. And this is one of the reasons I'm here tonight. Is a few years ago, the Saints Foundation raised money to buy a Lucas machine for St. Francis. The same Lucas machine that kept my heart pumping for over an hour. I mean, think about it. As well-intentioned as anybody is, you can't perform CPR on somebody for 60 minutes. So your donations saved my life. It really did. And for that, I'm eternally grateful. So how do you thank people? It's not always easy. It's not always easy to tell people or to be grateful for what we have. Because we all have issues. We all have problems. How do we show God that we're grateful? It's not easy. But how we can do it is by the actions that we take. By the time, how we lead our life, what do we do with it? Smile. Open a door for somebody. Do a kind gesture. Help when you can. That's when you know you make a difference, because trust me, everybody and anybody can make a difference in somebody else's life. And in my case, I'm very grateful that all of you did, because it sure changed mine. I'll leave you with a quick anecdote. After my wife realized and I realized that I was out of the woods, we were thinking about renewing our vows because of everything that happened. Little things. So then it got me thinking. I said, yeah, okay, yeah, the vows. Yeah, you know, yes, health and sickness and death do us part. And then I'm going, wait a second, I died. So then my wife says, does that mean I'm off the hook? So I asked the doctors, and they technically didn't declare me dead. So I had to tell my wife, I said, I'm sorry, honey, you're not off the hook. You're going to have me for a long time. And then that's what she says, I'll take that any day. Thank you. Thank you so much.